You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Johnson.
The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California. Presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com. And streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies. This is AfterBuzz TV's Real World After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's Real World After Show.
Roxy has nuts in her teeth.
Yeah, just whoa. Nuts stuck in my mouth right now. I'm like,
aye, aye, aye.
It's okay, the... People are going to be like, what the hell are you playing this old-ass song for? And yeah, what up, AfterBuzzers? Bing is for doing, and we are here doing another AfterBuzz TV After Show for the Real World, A-Nia-lation Proclamation.
Nia.
It's your boy DJ Jesse Janedy, joined in studio by Roxy Striar. My chair just went down. Ronnie Jr.
Hello.
We're going to have Nicolette Gaona calling in. And we might have a special surprise guest calling in. If not, they're going to definitely call in next week. So we'll get to that in a little bit. Good episode?
Yeah. I mean, obviously.
This is the episode we've been talking about all season.
Luckily, we got to see this before. And the fact that it kept my attention twice is like. Insane.
And I forgot that you guys already saw it too. So yeah. I'm kind of glad you didn't tell me that because I'm watching it for the first time, like, and you guys are like, ah-ing again.
Again, yeah. Because it really was, I think this is the culmination of the season as of this point. You know, this was like the boom breaking point. Even though last week was where all the fight was, I love the fight, but the aftermath is even more crazy in my mind.
I also thought this was a good episode because it felt like it was a longer, and usually when you say something's longer, it's like a worse, you know, type of show. Yeah. But it felt like there was so much that we saw, a lot of depth, a lot of layer to, you know, to everything.
Yeah, I mean, the Avery and Johnny thing I could have did without, but, I mean, it's
cutesy.
Yeah, I think it was necessary because otherwise we're sitting here thinking, where the hell are these kids? But was it...
Which is kind of what I was thinking about Jessica towards the end of the
episode. Bird, I always think the same thing on her.
No, I really this was Bird's episode.
Well,
yeah.
This one, but I'm saying in past episodes, she's the floater or whatever.
Yeah, absolutely, but...
She's a bird, she's always flying around.
I hate to have... I mean, we're going to talk about this in a little bit, but I have very good things to say about Bird this episode, and it's going to only seem like because I'm on Team Jordan, but I just liked Bird this episode. And we'll talk about it specifically.
But before we do
that,
I want to address the fans on YouTube. We love you guys, and we totally appreciate you guys commenting every single week. As far as, you know, who we like on the show, what we do here at AfterBuzz is we analyze each episode and each character. And as far as why we like, a lot of people are confused why we like Jordan and how can we even, they can't even understand why we like Jordan. Listen to our podcast better. No, I'm just kidding. But at the end of the day, you know, a lot of it is we are going based off of, especially this season, we're going based off of this episode. We were at the after show, so we kind of saw a different side, a different take of these characters, and we put the pieces together as we're watching the season. So, and even, you know, with Nia, kind of, this episode is a turning point a little bit for Nia. Obviously, we see in the future she's, I don't know. What kind of rampage she's going on. But again, I just think tonight's episode was another reason as to why we like Jordan. You kind of, yes, he does, you know, asshole things. It's a Peter Griffin type situation.
Yeah.
He's an asshole, but at the same time, there's redeeming qualities about his character.
You know, I think it's important to say also, Jesse, on that note, when you say we, it's not like before the show comes on, we all sit and decide. We like this character we and congregate. We don't. We all have our own opinions. And as you guys have seen in Real World in the past, we completely disagree on people all the time. It just so
we are actually agreeing yeah. this season.
And not only that, people have layers. There's types of the, you know, you watch a couple episodes, you're like, I really am starting to like their new development. Right. That's what makes the Real World so good is it's these stories. Yes, we see the drinking, we see the craziness, but it is people's stories, and you're gonna see their highs, their lows. So, I mean, when we do AfterBuzz, that's what we're judging, what we saw right there and then. Thank you, YouTube.
You know, well, I mean, and like you said, Roxy, Bird was the perfect example for this episode, because I guess watching this episode first, we didn't really base an opinion off of her.
Right.
You know, we kind of were looking at her differently. Then as we started the season and, you know, went through it, we couldn't stand her or, you know, had these different opinions by her. But now it kind of all, like you said, it kind of all falls into character development.
And we all have different opinions on it still. So now let's get into the ish.
So, yeah, there's going to be a falls trip. Nia is still pissed at Jordan about this whole situation. It's kind of the day after. All right, let's just get into it. And, well, you know, within this, we'll also talk about the after show. And, you know, because obviously, we know you guys watched it at home, but we sat there for, I mean, how many hours was that we were sitting in there?
The taping, yeah.
They edit a lot of it out. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Miss Coral. So out of this whole thing, you know, I kind of feel like Marlon is being used as a pawn.
I feel
through
so bad.
Nia
through Nia. She's like, no, she's like totally knowing exactly how to play him. Mm-hmm. And he has her back so badly here. And I'm like, honey,
I don't think he knows why he has her.
You gotta look at the bigger situation. Like, I think after he watched this episode, he probably was like, wow, I don't know. But this is the exact problem. This is where the race issue comes to play. And it's going to be a very difficult issue to talk about in this episode right now, because anything you can say about race, somebody can take offensively. Mm-hmm. So whatever I say, I have to preface with the fact that I'm not attempting to offend anybody at all. But I just think that racism is determined when you side with somebody based on their race. And I feel like from the beginning, Marlon saw Nia come into the house and was like, this is my girl, this is my black girl. And, like, it didn't matter about who she actually was.
She could be a bitch.
She could be a bitch. But all he saw was, like, this is somebody I can relate to because we have the same color skin. And I can get that on some level, mm-hmm. but I obviously can't fully understand that. So I feel like, in his eyes, she does no wrong, which is wrong. And that, to me, is a form of racism.
Now, when
does
you
that
say,
make sense?
Yep, and I just want to clear up because I know someone could take that.
Yeah.
When you say, I can't fully understand it, do you mean in the sense of, because what I think you're saying it as is, I can't understand personally, because, I mean, even if we were to be in a room, just because a white person comes in, oh, well, I can relate to them. Just because
right.
she has brown hair, she has brown hair. Or are you saying that, or just you can't speak as a colored African-American?
Both things. Honestly, I was saying that I can't speak as a colored African-American, but it also doesn't happen to me where, and maybe it's because I'm not
well, you're Jewish,
in the minority.
So would you be able to relate to a Jew more than...
I guess, like, if a Jew... But you don't know. When somebody walks in the room, you don't know they're Jewish.
Right.
You know, it doesn't jump out at you like that. So I don't know. It's not something I can... I mean, like, it's not like when you walked into the room for the first time, I was like, boom, that's who I'm going to relate to.
We're from Boston.
Because he's a white male from Boston. You know, like, it wasn't like that for me. But I do understand that there's different cultures and there's different things. So I can't speak as an African-American male.
No.
I'm not one.
Or woman. People definitely utilize that sometimes where you can want to bond with somebody because of, that could be ethnicity, that can be where you come from, that
right.
could be all sorts of things. But I think with Marlon, maybe the combination of what led him to act the way that he did would probably be the idea that he had feelings for her at some point. That's mm-hmm. And I didn't even kind of comprehend into what you just said, that yes, this is my sister and I'm going to kind of hold her down. And just, I think also he had a moment where he felt like he's trying to be a man in this house. All this stuff's going on. And if you notice, he said, I'm going to, you know, I held in to want to pop off with him, you know?
Right.
So there's a lot going on in his head. And I think he maybe told himself he had to do that, you know?
And I think there's a lot going on the phone right now. I think we have Nicolette Gaona on the line.
What's up, y'all?
Hi.
Girl, what are you, at a bar or something?
First of all,
No, I'm just in Kentucky over here, you know, and I'm here to get dirty.
We miss you, and YouTubers miss you, and they're like, where's that hot girl? She needs to come back because you'll get more viewers. And I'm like, get your ass back to California, girl.
Not even. That's why I'm calling in right now, you know, to show my support here, you know, for the real world.
Well, you know, what did you think of tonight's episode?
Okay, there was a lot to this episode. I mean, figuring out whose fault it was, who they should blame. We all know, we've seen this episode before, and we all kind of agreed that Jordan didn't do that much wrong.
Right.
Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, we have Nia over here acting crazy, like, thinking she's right. I don't get it.
Well, okay, so back to the pawn situation. You know, I really start when Marlon was standing at the kitchen table and Jordan came over and Nia had initiated a conversation with him. Well, not a conversation, an argument with Jordan. And even when we went to the after show, I feel like Nia wasn't really bothered by the race thing. It was more, I was offended that you came into the house. I was offended that you came into the room, I'm sorry, and were touching me at night and spit on me. I felt like she was more worried about those things. And then once Marlon brought the race thing in, if you notice, that's exactly when Nia went and put her elbow on him and was like, yeah, ooh, yeah, yeah, kind of like a coach, like, yeah, yeah, egging him on.
Marlon, I cannot stand Marlon. I feel like he's, A, just trying to get showtime, okay, because we all know he really does have a storyline if he's not going to go gay, you feel me?
Right.
So, at the end of the day, he's just over here trying to be in the conversation, trying to be relevant. Okay, maybe he's trying to help Nia out, but at the end of the day, you know, he wasn't even there. And so that's how I feel about that.
I actually like Marlon, though. I just feel like he's being misled. Like, I think he's a good human being, and that's what I look for on the show. Like, I try to look into people's souls as much as we can, and I think that he's a good person. So I like him. I just think that he's like he talked about, he moved a lot in his life, and I just think that he's too trusting kind of people.
And he does want to seek comfort, you know? So if she is the person to allow him to seek that comfort, the moment the situation comes off of Jordan and becomes a race thing, he, again, I feel like he feels that he needs to step up.
He's looking for familiarity somewhere, so he's like trying to, he wants to be on one side of the argument or the other, so he picks one side and then he goes with it with everything he has.
Yeah, Nicola, what were you gonna say?
No, I was just saying, you know, but we both all saw him at the reunion show and he was kind of acting like he was talking over everybody, trying to say and kind of state his opinion, but it really wasn't going anywhere. You know what I mean? It was just always like defending. I don't know.
Well, the way you guys saw him, I mean, you three who went to go to this taping and how you could judge him in that sense could always be different, because when you see these people on their, you know, after shows or whatever, they've already seen themselves on TV a little bit, so maybe they are trying to mask or act different. You've seen that in several seasons, you know?
Right. And
they act
actually,
different.
Nicolette, we're actually going to let you off because it's very loud.
Is it too loud?
Yeah.
Okay, we miss you, girl.
So love, and I'm sorry I can't be there, but I'll be there next week.
So she'll be back in studio next week.
Okay, here's what I'll say. Nicolette brings up a good point off of that, and it just got me thinking, and I kind of forgot about this. To be perfectly honest, when we were there, Marlon was being a little bit of a fame whore, and it wasn't his story to talk about. He had
the most,
but he felt like he had the most right to speak. And you know what I mean? Like, there were four of them there. There were four of them at the taping of the after show. And Bird was actually laying there. And Nia and Jordan were the two. She was lying there. Sorry. Bird was actually lying there. And Nia and Jordan were the two in the fight. And Marlon wasn't there at the beginning.
But do you notice that Bird and Marlon were actually doing the most
talking.
They were kind of like their coaches. The other two were kind of more, right? Weren't they kind of more docile? And then
right.
Nia was really
quiet. That's why I don't have a problem with what Bird did this episode, but I do with what Marlon did, because Marlon made it his fight to fight when it wasn't his fight to fight, and Bird just tried to make everything breathe and surface the truth.
And, you know, speaking onto that, I can understand the sense of Marlon walked into the situation. So maybe in his mind, okay, Jordan's drunk. You know, I've seen him drunk before. He gets in people's faces. Because he did mention, I hate that he yells at you guys and gets in your faces like y'all are dudes. So there could be a worry.
That was, you know, a spot on imitation right there.
Right. Like, he was worried about it, you know. So I understand that part of it. But it also, as a, just a person with morals, it's, okay, this is a heated argument. One is obviously drunk. Like, and it's whatever time in the morning, everyone go to sleep, end the situation, and like Bert said, breathe, let it come back in the morning, instead of the next morning, obviously, if the two are arguing, and now you're going to keep jumping into it, and then on top of it, having Jessica, who probably annoyed me the most in this episode.
Didn't you just want to punch her in the goddamn face?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have other words for it. I know she's your, like, you think she's cute, so
no,
cute and sweet.
I mean, I don't love her, but, yeah.
Jesus Christ, I couldn't this episode. But I completely agree with you, Jesse, and I have something to say on that matter, just in general, overall, with dealing with drunk people on the show. I'm assuming everybody who's been on the show has also watched this show. Also assuming everybody who's been on the show has been drunk before. Are those both fair assessments?
Mm-hmm,
okay. I'm not saying that anybody is forcing you to drink, Jordan, or forcing you to drink, Nia, or forcing anybody to drink. But you are drunk. So however you got that way, you're drunk.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with drunk people? What is the best way to deal with them? Is it the time to have a rational conversation?
Mm-mm.
No. And Nia specifically says, I was trying to make a mockery of you.
Mm-hmm.
She doesn't say, I was trying to talk to you, but then you were drunk. She knew how drunk he was, and her point, what she wanted to do, was make a mockery. And
as soon as he caught her in that, she stopped talking. Because you got caught. It's what it is.
And that has to do with both Johnny and Jordan this episode. They're, when you are blackout drunk,
yeah,
you, yes, you can be held accountable for your actions because they're still you, but there's no rationalizing with you while you're in that state.
Right.
Wait until the next day. What are you doing trying to rationalize or trying to pick a fight with or make a mockery of a drunk person?
Well,
it's not actually them.
I mean,
it is, but it isn't.
I know we're going to have Nia as a guest coming soon, and this is definitely something that I want to speak to her on. Is this a character that she went on and played? Because it just seems too overplayed. It just is like, why are you attacking Jordan? You know, one thing she said to Taylor tonight, you know, or to everybody, she said, I rode for Jordan the hardest. No, you didn't. Yeah, you did say, I can see the side of him, but at the same time, it's yin and yang. You were going against him in that. Now, I'm not condoning Jordan beating his chest. Now, with the N-word, I don't think anyone should be using it. I understand the case on every angle. I've heard it all. But I don't think it's right for them to be throwing names like that. Well, not Marlon, because Marlon really didn't say it during the initial argument. What Nia's saying, you're saying it to someone who is drunk, who is literally repeating what you're saying.
To amp him up.
Right. Know? And you have a lamp in his face. You know, so I'm not condoning the beating of the chest. I know he was trying to be riled up in the situation. People do dumb things, but at the end of the day, that's when the next day, instead of yelling at him, you pull him inside and say, look, bro, we're living in this house. And that's where Marlon, to me, is wrong. He should have, as the middle person, like Bird was trying to calm them down, sat him down and said, look, as an African American, I'm offended.
Right.
You know, forget that it was a female. Forget all this. As an African-American, as your roommate, I am offended by what you did. And I guarantee you Jordan would have, like, because Jordan did say, he said, you know, there were things I did last night that I shouldn't have done. He said, but I'm not going to apologize because I was provoked.
This is a hard thing to talk about again, but when we went to see the after show, there was a conversation that was happening between Nia and Marlon, and they're sitting there and they're talking about the usage of the N-word and how it's okay for them to use and what they mean, and Nia refers to herself as the N-word, mm-hmm, and says that all black women are, and Coral stops her and says, don't clump me in that category, yep, because that's not how I feel. Don't tell me how I feel. Don't group me in with you because I am not on that page. And that was really interesting to me.
And she also said, because Nia boldly stated, and I actually spoke to Nia about this today, boldly stated, I was not offended by him using the word. And she said she doesn't care when friends use it. She doesn't care what race you are if you use it. There's a difference between being derogatory. And she said, at the end of the day, I didn't even take offense to that. And I thought that was interesting because then even Coral stepped in again and said, whoa, whoa, whoa. Like, no, it just shouldn't be used. Coral was under the impression it just shouldn't be used.
Right.
Marlon was under the impression of, you know, I'm black, I can say it. Nia was like, anyone can say it. I don't really care. It doesn't bother her. So even within Marlon and Nia, you're fighting for the same battle, but it's a whole different war you guys are against.
That's what I was saying from the beginning. It's a problem when Marlon steps in to fight Naya's fight, and he doesn't even know what mm-hmm. he's fighting for.
Right.
And everyone's individual. I mean, you can't just mm-hmm. put a clump in as far as how you feel and how, even within Coral, you know, we've heard for, you know, years and years, you know, people that are light skin or versus a dark skin, they have different views on racism or whatnot. I mean, she shouldn't have used it. It's not good to be used, and she ramped his ass up, and that's what we saw.
And she was the perfect person to host the after show just because, you know, her and the Miz had that situation.
God,
and, you
over
know,
10 years ago or something.
And they hated each other, and the fact that they overcame it, became best friends, like, and, you know, to see Nia and Jordan are cool now, so I like that. Now, Marlon, like you said, Roxy, I think is a good person. I think he's being used as a pawn. Apart, like Nia says, she knows how to play the game. Well, Marlon, Mr. Anaconda, or Black Mamba, you are being played to the fullest. But Jessica, we're going to leave Marlon alone for a second. Let's go to Jessica.
Sweet Jessica.
No, not sweet Jessica, because this girl's crying. Why are you even in the room?
This was the outdoor scene.
It's just so. Well, no, when they were in the kitchen, she's sitting and crying and hugging Avery, and he's screaming and it's scaring me, and he's gonna. What if he hits someone? It's like you're making assumptions on someone's character. Jordan has not hit one person in the house. He has not physically threatened anybody in the house.
That's true. The only thing is, if she is a soft person, it comes from a different type of environment, and that is her honest feelings. So that's what makes it fun to watch.
But you should not be in the kitchen. Bird wasn't in the kitchen. Avery wasn't in the kitchen. They all left.
I guess I understand. When you say those are her honest feelings, who am I to tell somebody they can't feel the way they feel? I'm not. So if those are her honest feelings, then they are. But my question is, why? Why are those your honest feelings? Why are you so pissed, scared, sad? I just don't get it. And Bird says, don't make this a Jess Jordan thing.
Right.
And that's all I kept thinking. Like,
that's
this
right.
has
they were,
nothing
they...
to do with you, so why are you? And you know what? Sometimes I'm irrationally scared. Sometimes I'm irrationally pissed off. And I get that, but So maybe that's what it was. But if there's actually something there, I'm just wondering, and I want to ask her, and I guess we will eventually. So, like, Jessica, why did you feel the need to step in here and make it your issue?
It's almost like there's a wounded soldier, and, you know, you just walked over there and kind of just threw salt in the wound. In the sense of, like, they're talking about a bigger issue and a bigger problem. And now, Jessica, you're going off of something that you quickly just saw. Because you said, oh, Jordan was on top of her and he was biting her.
Well, Nia
initiated that entire thing, and they were totally playing around in the computer.
Oh, the beginning part, yeah.
Okay.
It was a whole sexually charged situation in which Bird saw the entire thing. And that's the one thing that Bird was fighting at the after show. She was like, I saw the whole thing. And I'm glad that she did walk out there and, you know, like you said, made the statement, don't make this a Jordan thing, because Nia's not telling the full truth.
Yeah.
Jordan should have stopped and not have gone to her room when she said, get out of my room. But at the same time, Nia kept going into his room and instigating.
I think that Bird did a really good job of not taking sides here. because she saw the whole thing and she realized that neither of these people are 100% in the right. And I agree with her there. And I can talk in a minute about how I do think in some ways Nia is in the right. I'll get there in a minute. But the few things I think that Bird said to Jordan, I care about your feelings. Sometime it's Jordan against the world. And instead of talking to you, she's talking to everyone. Yeah. Those are the three things that stood out to me.
Those are nice.
I didn't like that Jordan kept to himself and I like that Jordan kept to himself. It is between you and Nia. I didn't like that Nia tried to get everybody in the house on her side. If you're so offended and so hurt by something, you need to deal with it yourself and talk to the other person before you involve the rest of the house into your shit. That they don't need to be in that melting pot and you're making everybody pick sides, that's not fair. Also, I just felt like Bird in this moment and in other moments too, even though she annoys the crap out of me sometimes, like Marlon, I think she's genuinely a good human being, mm-hmm. and she was trying to get the truth out. Bird's always involved in everybody's business. We wouldn't expect any less here, but actually in this one, she is actually on the couch, so she has something to say about it. So I thought she handled herself really well. When she went, she never was like, you're totally right. Anytime, she played devil's advocate the whole time.
She
right.
wasn't, yeah.
Exactly. And then you guys can respond, and then I want to talk about what I do think I have Nia's back for.
Well, the only thing I was going to say about her is I do feel like Jordan, yes, he stayed separate on his own, and then Nia kind of riled everyone up. Also, I feel like how many of them wanted to be part of, even though she riled them up, how many of them ran to her, wanted to be part of the hate Jordan, little train.
It's a dramatic crew.
Yeah, so, I mean, I'm sure she roped them in, but they also were going for that, too, is kind of what I saw. My favorite, though, was when Johnny just got pissed and had everyone kind of shut up. And
I like Johnny really didn't get involved too much. He kind of was just like, can we just all chill? With that, one thing that, again, I'm really excited to talk to Nia because where I feel like I don't really know if I believe her 100% is she was kind of just piggybacking. When Avery said, Jordan bit you? Yeah, he bit me. Well, where's the bite mark? Because that was the one thing. We saw he threw her on the bed.
We saw him nibble her leg
for
a second.
It was playful. If he really, we've seen I've seen Bad Girls Club, Real World. We've seen people get hurt before by other people. Come on. It wasn't that bad. You weren't crying over it. But then when Jessica was saying, yeah, he does this, and this, and I was like, yeah, he does. Again, just playing the game. Yeah, whatever you guys have, let's just put it in the deck all against Jordan. So stack the guns.
Okay.
Now, where do you agree?
I completely agree with you with what you just said. And I'm not trying to say that what she did was right. But what I will say is I understand personally when a guy physically touches me in a way that is not comfortable, is not consoling or sexually like mutual or something, when a guy lays his hands on you, being a small girl, which she is, she's a tough bitch like I am too, but something changes. There's a dynamic that changes, and I think she pushed him to that point, so that's not right. But in her defense, when a man lays his hands on you in any sort of way, it just changes the entire room. I don't know how to describe it better than that, but for a big athletic guy to even push a girl like that on the bed, even though I think he was provoked, and even though it wasn't right for her to do anything she did, because she should show the same respect and not put her hands on him, I just don't ever feel comfortable with a bigger guy or any guy putting his hands on a girl, period.
I get that. I understand that, especially with her past.
Right.
With that situation, because I know what that can lead into mentally, especially if you're laying in bed and he's coming in. And, again, your defenses go up, your walls go up. I get that. But at the same time, why I feel there's a game being played here is because you damn well knew.
Totally.
You started this entire thing. You wanted to play him. You wanted to provoke him. What's the difference with him coming into the room when you kept coming into there? Now, she claims there was editing involved with this whole situation. So, And I'm glad we got to see the after show because I don't want to ask the questions coalesced. Right. I have deeper questions that I want to ask her as far as, well, okay, I want to know what exactly was edited out. You know, what? And then, you know, when we get Jordan on, we're going to compare both the stories.
And what she did is like the fine line because, yes, any man will say we definitely should not put our hands on a woman right. under any circumstance. But then if it was sort of like her, you know, showing for the camera or provoking for a certain reason, that's a tough situation for the way he ended up reacting. That was a reaction. But yeah, no, we should.
And he's never also he's never given her any cause. Anybody in the house, any cause to believe that he would hit a woman.
I agree with that. But here's what I'm thinking. I think she was provoking him. I don't think she thought this was going to be the outcome. I think she thought she was provoking him, and for some reason, it was going to turn into either something sexual or playful. I don't think this is how she thought it was going to end up.
How do you think she thought it was going to end
up? I think she thought, you know, she's like going and bringing him Cheerios and all this stuff. I think she thought he was going to like cave and like cuddle with her or something, like something more sexual. I think that she didn't. However, I think she thought it was going to end up. I don't think it was like this.
How does Steve think it was going to end up?
I don't know, Steve. How do you?
Steve the Steamer?
Oh.
Steve the Steamer's on the line.
What's up, guys?
Steamer!
How you doing, Jesse?
Steamer, all right.
I just think we're all dumber for having watched that whole conversation go down. Like, the past 2 weeks, that's all we've been inundated with is that same argument between them. It's just like, both of them are just stupid. Like, why do we have to keep going back to it? Like Jordan, I don't understand how you guys like him so much. I just can't figure that out.
Well,
I feel bad for the guy. Like, you can tell, like, there's something wrong with him, like he expressed at the end of tonight's episode. But at the same time, it's on him to try to get together with his roommates to say, you know, you can't just be abrasive all the time. That's what he's been. So I don't like blame like Marlon for going after him.
Well, in the sense of Marlon going after him with what?
No, like tonight where he's like confronting him about what Jordan did like the night before with Nia, like who Nia is like probably the worst cast member I've seen on the show. Like,
oh, she's
I
my.
I don't even know why she's there. She's atrocious. But
well, still,
I think she's the
Jordan
best.
Can't be going in like the way he did.
No, she is the best character to ever hit the real world in the sense of.
She's so freaking phony. Like before the season started, they show like the old real world. That's what it should be about. Like I don't want this phony crap on the real world. That's what she is. I don't want her being a character. Like. That's just bullshit. Like,
well, I agree with Steamer.
Yourself.
I don't think anyone wants to
like
see a show.
Leroy's like the best one who's ever been on the show. Nia's like the antithesis of that. She's so phony. She's like calculated. Like, move that on to the end of the show. Let's get back to the real world.
Well, as far as Jordan.
I'm Steamer. Oh, I missed you.
Welcome back.
Hell yeah.
Steamer, as far as Jordan, I mean, let's look at, you know, you said he's so abrasive and, you know, in every situation, honestly, I look at it, except the one where he started, like, going back and forth between Jessica. But I just think Jessica was being just as dumb when it came to, like, the job and how much she made.
Yeah,
like
I agree. Jessica sucks, too.
But now I want you to answer this. This morning, in the episode, when they woke up, when Jordan approached Marlon and Nia, I felt... From what I was watching, I felt Jordan approached very calmly, and the only reason he started getting abrasive was because Marlon smacked the drink out of his hand and started yelling at him, and then they started turning it into a race war. And I feel like, yes, you can throw blame on Jordan for that, because at the same time, too, because as a grown adult, I know my ass wouldn't have reacted that way. I would have looked at Marlon like, you're an idiot, you really just hit this cup out my hand, and how are you going to feel if I did this to you right now? But Jordan doesn't think that way. None of these people think, I don't think anyone in this house thinks rationally. Honestly, I really don't. I can't think of one. Maybe Bird.
But honestly, Bird was the voice of reason tonight, yeah. For sure.
But so in this situation, I really can't. I understand people seeing this perception of Jordan, but if you look at the big picture of it, I just feel like he's provoked too much. It's like if you know how someone reacts, it's like a tiger. If you know a tiger is going to rip your arm off, well, why the hell are you going to keep poking it? Why are you going to walk around the tiger? Why are you going to interact with the tiger? You got to find a certain way to deal with people and situations, kind of like Taylor. And it was, Taylor kind of brought some reality into the...
I freaking love Taylor. I want Taylor on the show.
I think in your notepad it says, I heart
Taylor. I love Taylor. It really
it's
does.
A heart.
I also wrote, I love Jordan, but I heart Taylor. But I have a question for Steamer here. Okay, Steamer, we just were talking about how you don't like phony people. You want Nia off the show because you want the real world. I feel, in my opinion, Jordan seems to be the least phony. He seems to be like, what you see is what you get. And you might not like his personality, but don't you feel like he, and this is a loaded question, but don't you feel like he's the exact kind of person you want on the real world if you're looking for somebody who's real?
Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with you. I don't mind him being on the show. Like, just like Frank went on Frank's season. Like, yeah, there's some phoniness in Frank, but I felt like he was being at least semi-real. Like, I didn't like him whatsoever, but I liked him on the show. So I agree with that perspective. I just mean in terms of, I don't know why you're always defending him, because Jesse brings up a good point. Like, this is like poking a tiger. But at the same time, the tiger is still responsible for how it acts. Like, he should be trying to, it's not just on the roommates to say, how come Jordan's acting this way? Jordan has to make some compromises himself, which maybe he will do after what we saw at the end of tonight's episode. And if he does, good on him. Like, there is some, you can tell there's some quality human being in there, so you hope it comes out eventually.
And
I don't see him like as an evil person, but at the same time, he needs to make those compromises as well.
Well, and I you know, where I see the reason I do is because I see with certain situations, and I guess part of me also is relating Jordan to specific people in my life that I have had to deal with, in the sense of just kind of getting them to let their walls down. And at the same time, like, yes, okay, if these people are so affected by the way Jordan reacts, to me, what I've seen this season is everyone just takes that and then attacks. Versus, finally, Bird, I feel, said, okay, no more attacking. Let's have a conversation with this kid. And he actually let his wall down and, you know, spoke about a suicide letter and his father.
But he never uses the word.
No, never.
Which was really interesting to me.
And again, you know, these are the things. This is why you go on the real world. This is why, even at the end of the season, Nia may change, and we may just, you know, like, understand why Nia does the things she does. And for me, why I stick up for Jordan is because he's a glass house, and he's the realest person on the show, because he does everything with honesty. Whether it's good or bad, I defend it because I feel like he is reasonable enough. Look at who his best friend is. You know what I mean? Fact that, and maybe that's why.
If you want to know who somebody is, look at their friends. That's what everybody
and
says.
I just think you have to deal with him in a certain way. He reminds me of my little brother, and I hope my brother's not watching this right now. But you have to deal with certain people certain ways. You know, with Nia, she's being a little, she's being very manipulative. And so it's hard to kind of work with her because I don't know what I'm getting the truth from.
The reason I think he's likable is because when you watch these shows, like Steamer's talking about, you want to see kind of like a storyline or growth or whatever. Like, you've seen in so many episodes, back in the New York one, it was Mike, you know, The Miz. He went from walking in the door acting this way, leaving the house a different way. Wes, same thing. He had it. Julie from New Orleans. I mean, everyone, he might be that character, and maybe that is why we're enjoying him so much, because he's the one who we can see some change with as far as Jordan.
One more thing. Steamer, I want you to go back to St. Thomas and how much you despised Trey, right?
No, I like Trey.
Yeah, what are you talking about?
Wait a minute. When he was talking to all the girls, the way Trey was treating all the girls.
You talking about me who hated Trey?
Was it you? Okay. Well, all of us, in the sense. But to me, Jordan has more redeeming qualities. Jordan's never given us a reason to. He's never been disrespectful to a female, he treats everybody equally. I don't know. Do you?
Yeah, I mean, he doesn't play favorites. It's if that's possible. What you mean. But I think that the problem here is we go two steps forward and then one step back. We get quotes from Jordan at the end. I hate the tango. I hate the easy road. I can do it in silence.
A little kid.
But that's the tough. That's the tough exterior he's trying to put on. But now that you mentioned Trey, who I hate, I didn't even like St. Thomas season at all, really, at all. But whoa, yeah, no, Trey was bad.
It took me Jordan to meet is not, Trey in order to
okay.
like.
Yeah, Jordan has got. He's got something to watch, and yes, he's doing that. We all do that. Or I mean. and you have had times where you put on, like, I was in a conversation recently with somebody the other day where I was just like putting on, like, you want to, that's all he was doing. I don't know. Now I'm liking Jordan a little more than even, now that we're diving into the character a little bit.
All right, let's move on to Jordan's friend, Taylor. She's clearly in love with this kid.
I wrote that down, do you think?
Do you, like, think or you don't think?
I don't know. I just think she's such a cutie pie, and, like, I don't know if she's in love with him.
You don't know? Yeah, she totally is.
You guys all say that, and I guess maybe. But don't you have, like, I have this one guy friend that I treat like that, too. I'm like, oh, I'm, like, always hanging on. And, like, I know me, and I know I'm not in love with him. But everybody always is like, you guys are so in love, and we're always like, no, we're not. But I'm like, oh, I care about who he's going to end up with, and I hope she's right, and take me out, let's go out. It's like the whiny voice, that needy, whiny person that you're with. So maybe it's just that. I want to give her the benefit of the doubt because, you know, it's like, I just feel bad. If it's unrequited love, that sucks. You know, she loves him so much, he clearly doesn't love her. We know that. He's not in love with her, I can tell. So I'm just hoping that.
I just don't think he's mentally capable of realizing that he actually, and I think she knows that, which is why she doesn't chase after it, capable of knowing that that could be an amazing relationship.
Yeah, I guess so. You know what? Maybe they'll end up together. Maybe that's what's best. I just feel bad for girls that are such good friends and always there for them. And then everybody's like, oh, it's because they're in love.
Roxy's
like
flipping it. All right. Well, yeah, let's flip it to the other relationship. Avery and Johnny.
Do we have to?
With the pizza situation. Where do you guys stand with this whole Johnny getting too drunk and then blaming it and saying he blacked out that night? And
that was he did black out that night, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I can't stand the girls when they're together in this house. Like you were saying, you feel like.
Oh, right.
That was a perfect example.
Right. You were saying that. Go ahead.
Well, the girls were looking at him and somewhat lackluster on some levels. And then I was like, oh, I like Avery. And then I think when we did the after show last time, we kind of like her a little, but then she does stuff to kind of get under our skin. If she had a better group of girls on this season, Avery would be fun. And Avery would not take herself to that
girl
person.
Place. Mm-hmm. It's just like, here's the thing. We're watching a show, and the guys are out, and they're at a bar, and they're watching football, and they're getting drunk, and they're having bro time. And fine, maybe you don't have to go with them, but Jesus Christ, girls, go out and do something.
You didn't get your pizza. Do something yourself. Figure
it
out.
Go get lunch. You're sitting in the house. I'm waiting for my boyfriend to come home and give me food.
She's becoming just as needy as her surroundings.
She's so needy, and I hate girls like this. And I'm like, come on.
Question. Now, with Avery, I do like Avery a lot, actually. She's actually probably, from the initial beginning, was probably the girl that, like, I would be friends with or even am rooting for.
Yeah.
My thing with her is I feel like she's like a Jordan in the sense of she has a lot of issues, and the real world could be a great place for her to figure those issues out, but she invested her time into another person, and I feel like she's not going to really develop her character.
I was just going to say that. Like, I would love to see her, like, not with him. As much as it's cutesy and all that, I kind of want, like, she rocked it. She was there, and we were going to see her, but now everything is linked up to him, which is going to be a problem this season.
This is what I've been talking about with my girlfriends, my roommates a lot recently. When you're in your young 20s, it's not okay to be boy obsessed.
Yeah.
You can't be, because you need to find yourself and your passion and what you want to do, and it has to be independent of a boy, of another guy. It just can't be like that. And when she, the next morning, she's pissed off and they're going to play disc golf or whatever, and she goes, and then they asked Johnny to go. And I was like, gosh darn it. Honey, I could read right through you. You were sitting there begging for them to ask him to go. Like, you just wanted him to go so bad, but you didn't want to ask him because that makes you look needy. Like,
and now
you
I'm
need
pissed
a passion.
That he's going.
You need to want your own life with outside of a guy. And, like, I just can't stand girls that are in their young 20s and they could have everything they want and any guy they want, but they're so obsessed with one guy that they lose sight of everything else. Mm-hmm. And that's Avery in a nutshell right now.
Where do you, Steamer, where do you stand with that whole pizza situation?
But are you really surprised that Avery's needy? She brought her dog to the real world.
No, I know.
I mean,
yeah.
What else do you need to know about the girl? She brought her dog. I mean, so obviously there's something mentally not functioning with her, which who knows what it is. I'm not going to judge that. But at the same time, that was like the key going in. Like, you do something goes off. But at the same time, like with the pizza.
Uh-oh.
I can see where she's coming from. Like, if they were just if they asked you what you wanted and you said like you wanted food, you were expecting it.
Right.
You were at least like a call. Like they could at least call and say we're not coming back with it. That's I can see her getting upset at that.
Okay, but she says she waited
kind of like
6 hours
around Johnny, but I don't really mind her.
She said she waited 6 hours. I understand if you are waiting an hour, the pizza doesn't come back, it's been a full hour, you're annoyed.
Right.
Yes, I understand you'd be annoyed not getting a call. At that point, I'd just leave.
Mm-hmm.
I would just go get myself some food. You can't tack on more hours and just be like, but you were gone 6 hours. Honey, at what point did you realize they weren't coming home with your frickin' pizza? Like, come on.
Good point.
Well, and again, I don't think... part of me wonders if Avery was the type of person to do that or if Jessica and Bird were sitting there. And because these girls are all adding on to it, because what seems to happen from what I'm seeing is once one person has an issue and the other ones kind of all want to weigh in on the issue and kind of build up the person.
The show already does that. Yeah, the show already does that. You're in the house cooped up and then you get three people to like say, well, how do you feel? And then you just go crazy and make it a bigger storm than it needs to be.
It's the fact that we're sitting here for 15 minutes talking over a slice of pizza. You know, this isn't a gourmet meal that you were pissed that you had to pay for. It's a slice of pizza. Pizza Schmitza is a block away. Walk there and see what's going on. Go get something else. There, every single thing with these girls comes into a whole big to-do.
But then I feel like then they kind of dropped.
Her ranch dressing.
Right. Well, and, you know, here's where Marlon, you know why Marlon really upsets me is because I have such high hopes for Marlon with this season. And, again, you know, we see a good quality in him is he goes into the room with John. He's like, dude, no one's mad at you. Like, calm down. They were just, you know, they're upset about the pizza. Like, come on, let's go. I like that approach.
He definitely wants to have fun. Marlon wants to have a good time. I like that, too.
What upsets you?
What upsets me is I feel like he runs off of emotion, and if he's not emotionally invested, he's more kind of laid back and relaxed. Whereas, like you stated earlier, I feel like he may have feelings for Nia, and that's where the whole, well, I got to stick up for the girls now and, you know, get like this. Well, because Johnny was yelling at the girls, so why weren't people bugging out? Because, Jessica said, I was worried about the way Johnny was yelling at us. You know, so it's why are we dealing with certain people different ways?
You mean the way Jordan was yelling at them?
No, Johnny. Remember when Johnny came home and he was yelling at all the girls?
Oh, that night.
In the house it was an issue when Marlon did it, but not when Johnny did. Yeah, Johnny's was a little smoother, huh?
Well, you know,
like, why it was
no
that
one
different?
Made it into a big deal, or Marlon
was
it, didn't make.
Why
it
do
into
we think that was? Was that because it was addressed differently the way Johnny did it?
Because I think because
it was smooth. It was very.
Well, no, I think it's because
not aggressive.
Right. Well,
it was loud though, but yeah.
Well, but Bird felt it was aggressive. Jessica thought it was aggressive.
God, this house is difficult. Everyone takes issues with every single thing one person does.
Everything. That's what I'm saying. Like, can't they ever just be like, can't they ever just chalk it up to the fact, oh, he was drunk?
We're all different people, and we're living in a house that's just accepting everyone's character.
Steamer, I got a question. Steamer, I got a question for you. When we were talking about, oh, Avery, I think she'd be cool if she had another cast of girls or even one different one. You know every cast member from every season. Who would you have liked to see in that house? I mean, just a person who has that type of style. Characteristic.
Like girls or?
Yeah, like for me, I said I think an Irulan type from the first Las Vegas would be so fun with an Avery versus the girl she has in there right now.
Yeah, I think anybody pretty much would be an improvement over who they have now.
No.
But yeah, that'd be a good choice for her.
All right, Steamer, my question for you is: who do you like the best, and who do you dislike the most?
Well, Nia by far I dislike the most. It's not even close. She's by far the worst house guest that they've ever
but
had.
She's so awesome, though, because in the sense that her as a person, maybe, and then her as a character on television, you know what I mean?
Well, like, we're not looking for characters on the real world.
Yeah, I don't want a character. If I want a character, I watch a sitcom. I watch a drama. I don't want to watch reality TV. Like, I don't want them to say, this is going to be good TV. No, I can watch good TV. I want to watch, like, real. So that's why, like, she's disqualified.
Did you appreciate
who I like the most? I don't know. I would say it's either Johnny or Marlon, or maybe Daisy. That's one of those three.
Daisy.
I still do love Johnny, too. I love Johnny.
I didn't like Johnny at the beginning. And
really?
Not that I didn't like him, but he was indifferent. And he's, like, very fun to watch. I really am enjoying his goofiness. He gets mad. He messes up. then he does good, and it just, the day goes by.
Don't you feel like Johnny, if it was a different cast, Johnny could be the star of the show, depending on who it was. Like, this could be a different season, and it could be all about John, but there's just so many major players this season.
I feel like these people were, like, their applications were from totally different places. Johnny should have been on the Jersey Shore. Nia should have been on the Bad Girls Club. Yeah. Like, they just, not made for the real world, some of these people.
And absolutely, Birch be on The Bachelor.
There you go.
Wow, that was
Jessica.
And both.
No, we'll find a better show for Jessica.
Both of it. Bird sitting there giving advice to the other bachelors.
Should be on Tool Academy.
Yeah.
All right. Let's head into predictions. Next week, basically, well, they kind of showed us what we're gonna get throughout the season.
TV. All I gotta say is, what's nice? I got your dog bitch thing going on. She stole the dog?
Herbert, how do you steal a dog and you're in the same house?
And that's your dog bitch.
And that's the person she ends up punching?
Yeah, she slams Avery's head.
So it's gonna be like Avery, like, getting a more of a backbone and maybe coming at Nia?
Avery and Jessica start the fight, and then Nia kind of jumps into it somehow, because while Avery and Jessica are yelling at each other, Nia's in the back kind of giggling.
But Avery tells Johnny that she got attacked.
Yeah. So. And then Nia versus Marlon, he says, I don't know if I can trust you. And then Bird versus her ex.
And Bird throwing shit at her boyfriend, mm-hmm. and like being like, get out. And Jessica sobbing, and Avery sobbing, and Bird sobbing, and everybody's sobbing.
Everyone's going to be fighting. Apparently, we're going to get a huge explosion. Nia's just going to be, like, running through everybody, I guess.
And we finally hear the words I've been waiting for Marlon to say to Nia. I don't know if I can trust you.
Yep.
And I'm like, go figure.
I'm super excited. And speaking about Nia, we're actually going to be interviewing her next week, so make sure you guys tune in for that. She's ready. She has her questions for us, and we have our questions for her. So if you guys have questions, make sure you guys
suck so much.
There you go. And I'm sure Steamer will have a lot of amazing commentary for her next week as well. If you guys want to keep in contact with us, tweet us at AfterBuzzTV on Facebook, Instagram, and if you guys have any questions for her or us, you guys can tweet me at DJ Jesse J,
at Roxy Striar,
at Ronnie Jr. Media,
and Steamer, where can we follow you?
At the Steamer.
Until next week, same time, same place.
Peace.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.